We will move on from there. The Minister of Finance and Personnel wishes to make a statement. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I am pleased to be able to present to the House the Executive's agreed budget for 2015-16 and the result of the 2014-15 January monitoring round. On the 23rd of December, the Stormont House Agreement was published, paving a new way forward for the Executive and a fresh start for politics in Northern Ireland. Its success or failure will depend upon the faithful implementation of what was agreed by the parties across a range of issues. Last Thursday, the Executive passed its first big test of this new era. This budget and the agreement that has been reached on welfare reform puts the Executive's finances back on a long-term and sustainable basis. It also paves the way for allowing Northern Ireland to set our own rate of corporation tax. I trust that the willingness to compromise and the determination to succeed and to meet deadlines that have made this budget possible will set the tone when the other aspects of the Stormont House Agreement come to be implemented. The challenging financial circumstances which the Executive had to contend with this year and next are well documented. Our overall spending power as an Executive has fallen by over £1 billion since 2010. Next year's resource budget has been reduced by 1.6% in real terms, meaning that our ability to pay for the day-to-day running of public services like schools and hospitals has been curtailed when demand for those and other services remain high. The years ahead look equally challenging, with Office of Budget Responsibility projections suggesting Northern Ireland could see its resource deficit fall by a further 13% in real terms by the end of this decade. In such circumstances, it would challenge the ability of any government to agree a budget. Never before has Northern Ireland had to contend with budgetary pressures of this magnitude. That we have been able to agree a budget for next year and have done so well in advance of the end of January is an achievement many thought beyond our reach. Mr. Deputy Speaker, our draft budget illustrated the difficulty of our task. Over £200 million in reductions were required across departments to meet many of the pressures facing the Executive. Members will recall that the draft budget contained no surplus funding to be distributed at the final budget stage, aside from the £30 million change fund. However, a number of factors, large and small, have combined to result in a much improved budgetary position. The Chancellor's autumn statement resulted in the Executive receiving £67 million more in resource deficit, £5.7 million in capital deficit, and £1.3 million of financial transactions capital for next year. The Stormont House Agreement provides the Executive with additional funding and flexibilities in 2015-16, and these include up to £50 million additional capital deficit for new shared and integrated education projects, flexibility to use £200 million of RRI borrowing for a voluntary exit scheme, an additional £100 million of borrowing for capital projects, and up to £30 million of resource deficit for the funding of bodies to deal with the past. Her Majesty's Government are still intent on enforcing the payment of £114 million for the non-implementation of welfare reform. This amount will be deducted from our budget at the beginning of the new financial year. If the implementation of welfare reform is completed, as expected, during 2015-16, then the relevant portion of the £114 million reduction will be returned to the Executive in year. The draft budget set aside £70 million to fund a package of measures to mitigate against the worst impacts of welfare reform. An assessment of the requirements next year has been made, and based on the assumption that welfare reform will be implemented halfway through 2015-16, it is anticipated that £26.9 million will be required. This funding will be transferred to DSD in June monitoring to be held in a ring-fenced manner for the various welfare reform initiatives. This revised costing of welfare reform measures therefore provides £43.1 million of additional funding for allocation in final budget. Flexibility was provided to fund the £114 million from the capital budget. As departments will have already commenced planning on the basis of the draft budget capital position, the Executive has agreed not to fundamentally alter this in order to repay the full £114 million from capital. However, a £57 million capital to resource switch has been granted as part of the final budget on the assumption that welfare reform will be introduced halfway through next year. This position may be then further refined in year. The Stormont House Agreement also confirmed that the £100 million reserve claim in 2014-15 may be repaid from capital receipts. This reflects the draft budget position. The ring-fence funding included in the Stormont House Agreement for bodies dealing with the past and for shared and integrated education projects is being held centrally, as proposed expenditure will require the agreement of both the Executive and the UK Government. Allocations will then be made through the in-year monitoring process. Further additional funding is available to the Executive due to revised assumptions and updated forecasts. This includes an increase of £1.3 million in regional rates income and a £5.9 million reduction in RRI interest repayments. In the draft budget, the Executive set aside £133.2 million to cover increased costs arising from the revaluation of public sector pension schemes. These costs have now been finalised after work between my department and the Government Actuaries Division, resulting in a reduction in the pressure of £10.7 million. Some capital-reduced requirements have been identified during the course of the consultation period, and these have been factored into the final budget position. These include some £5.7 million of increased capital receipts, £27.5 million of financial transactions capital from Derry, and £46 million of capital Dale from Decal for the regional stadium. In view of the circumstances in which the stadia funding was surrendered, I can confirm that I will support any in-year emerging capital infrastructure pressures relating to stadia emanating from Decal in the 2015-16 monitoring round process. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in the draft budget, £10.7 million of resource Dale and £8 million capital Dale was held centrally for match funding for EU peace programme and Interreg. The majority of this funding has now been allocated to the relevant departments. There has been some delay on the final agreement for some projects, and therefore a residual amount has been held centrally to allocate as part of the in-year monitoring process. Finally, DSD has requested the reclassification of £2.7 million of expenditure from resource Dale to capital Dale as a consequence of expenditure being incorrectly classified in the resource Dale baseline. As a result of all of the adjustments that I have just detailed, the funding available for allocation at final budget stage amounts to £73.7 million resource Dale and £28.8 million ring-fenced financial transactions capital. On conventional capital Dale, there is a small overcommitment of £2.3 million to be managed in year. The draft budget also set aside £30 million for an executive change fund. The aim of the fund was to encourage departments to bid for projects that were reform-orientated and innovative, focused on early prevention and intervention and prevention, or involved cross-departmental collaboration. The fund was oversubscribed by five times its value, illustrating its value and the commitment of ministers to the principles of reform. Bids were assessed and scored, and the 19 successful ones are outlined in the attached tables. Before moving to the further allocations agreed by the Executive, I want to say something about the Assembly Ombudsman, the Northern Ireland Audit Office, and the Northern Ireland Assembly, all of which were protected from reductions at draft budget stage. At that time, it was made clear that in times when the broad public sector was under such pressure, there would be a clear expectation from both the Executive and the general public that these institutions would also provide some degree of savings. Unfortunately, with the exception of the Ombudsman, who did at least try to identify some savings, that has not been the case. And both I and executive colleagues have been dismayed by the attitude taken by these bodies. I do not believe that these institutions are run so efficiently that they cannot play some part in keeping budgets to a minimal level. Therefore, the Executive has agreed to reduce the Northern Ireland Audit Office, Assembly Ombudsman and the Northern Ireland Assembly Commission's budgets by 5%. In the interest of fairness, it is only right that minor departments who had faced significant reductions at draft budget should have their reductions limited to a similar level. Therefore, the funding released by applying a relatively small reduction to the previously protected bodies has been returned to the NI Utility Regulator, the Food Standards Agency and the Public Prosecution Service. As a result, the adjustments made to the non-ministerial departments will have no impact on the levels of funding available to other departments. It will, however, ensure that all minor bodies are making a contribution to reducing public expenditure. Mr. Deputy Speaker, the central pillars in constructing this budget for 2015-16 were the protection of key frontline health and education services, investments that underpin economic growth in Northern Ireland, and putting in place the foundations for the reform and restructuring of our public sector. These important priorities are reflected in the various allocations agreed by the Executive. The Programme for Government commits us to delivering high quality and efficient public services, in spite of the dual pressures of less public spending than we'd like and the growing demands of our people. We ought to be proud of the many achievements departments have made. Those achievements can only be maintained and built upon if the Executive prioritises key services in its budget allocations. That, Mr Deputy Speaker, is what we have done. No clearer can that be seen than in our commitment to health and education. I can confirm the £200 million increase in spending for the Department of Health, Social Services and Public Safety originally outlined in the draft budget. Health will also receive a further £4 million from the Change Fund for five projects, including the All-Ireland Congenital Cardiac Service Model. This additional £204 million reflects the Executive's determination to protect frontline services in the health sector and sees a final budget outcome for health which is some 3.4% higher than last year. The Executive is also committed to assessing the performance of DHSS PS both in the short and longer term. As an initial step, my department will provide an assessment of the performance of DHSS PS as part of its monitoring round scrutiny over 2015-16 to ensure that its plans for remaining within budget are robust and attainable. In the longer term, the intention is to progress the health sector review through a case study to be undertaken as part of the ongoing OECD review into public sector reform in Northern Ireland. The flexibilities previously granted to DHSS PS in monitoring rounds will continue for 2015-16, subject to the outcome of the assessments undertaken. The Department of Education receives £63 million, as well as a change fund allocation of £1.6 million for nurture units in extra funding on top of that already allocated in the draft budget. This reflects not only the Executive's own commitment to a high-quality education system that contributes to the success of our economy and society, but is also a recognition of responses to our public consultation. I trust that this sizeable additional allocation will permit much of the pressures facing classrooms across Northern Ireland to be alleviated. Between them, these two departments, health and education, will account for 65% of all resource expenditure in Northern Ireland next year. One other significant allocation that I wish to highlight relates to the Department of Justice. During my bilaterals with departments, I discussed the pressures facing the Police Service of Northern Ireland with the Chief Constable. I am pleased to say that the Executive has agreed to a further £20 million to go to the Department of Justice, especially to meet pressures on the PSNI. This will assist the Chief Constable to take forward recruitment plans next year and ensure that the impact of reductions on policing and public safety are lessened. Mr Deputy Speaker, the Executive's number one priority remains growing a sustainable economy. That requires us to devote resources insofar as we can within the constraints we face to investment in economic infrastructure, skills development and job creation. Mr Deputy Speaker, the Executive's economic strategy is working. The economy as a whole is growing, unemployment is falling, confidence is creeping back. It is critical, therefore, that the Executive continue to concentrate investments on areas of expenditure that assist and support our economy as it recovers. I already indicated in the draft budget that close to £20 million of support to small businesses would be provided through the continuation of the Small Business Rates Relief Scheme. Members will recall that in my draft budget statement I announced my intention to create a Northern Ireland Investment Fund. This fund would be primed with financial transactions capital and would seek to work with the European Investment Bank to leverage in additional finance that could be targeted towards much-needed investment in infrastructure such as energy efficiency, renewables and social housing. I am pleased that the Executive has endorsed the allocation of a further £28.8 million of financial transactions capital to the Northern Ireland Investment Fund, meaning that some £40.9 million will be in the fund next year. The Department of Enterprise, Trade and Investments budget for 2015-16 was one of only two departments to experience an increase in the draft budget. After discussions with my colleague, the Economy Minister, I am convinced of the need for a further uplift in expenditure in her department so that the impressive work that she and Invest Northern Ireland have done to attract so much investment to Northern Ireland can continue. Deputy receives £3 million, which goes to Invest NI, as well as £7.4 million in change fund allocations, including one for collaborative skills development, that the department will undertake alongside the Department of Employment and Learning. Mr Deputy Speaker, I've made it clear in this House that the departmental allocation in the draft budget which satisfied me least was that to the Department of Employment and Learning. The final budget sees Dell receiving a total of £33.2 million, in additional funding. This is made up of £20 million in recognition of the work our universities and colleges do in building a skilled workforce, and £13.2 million of successful change fund bids, including joint work with the Department of Education to provide maths and English essential skills for 14 to 16-year-olds, the aforementioned collaborative skills development with DETI, the United Youth Programme pilot, and apprenticeships and youth training. As public spending remains under pressure for the foreseeable future, it will be important that the Executive pursue and seek to realise innovative funding solutions that help to meet our objectives. The House will know of my long-standing support for the third sector in Northern Ireland. Many of our charities, community organisations and social enterprises play a crucial role in working with government to deliver key services, particularly to the most marginalised and hard to reach in our society. I'm sure we are all in agreement in wanting to see the third sector increase its activity. To that end, I can announce that it is my intention to bring forward to the Executive a paper proposing the creation of a social innovation fund, which will allow social enterprises, charities, faith-based organisations and community groups to access loan financing that will enable them to expand the good work that they do. It is my hope that this fund will be able to utilise £5 million of funding from dormant accounts and, much like the investment fund, be constructed in such a way that it will be able to draw in additional finance that could see a total of £10 million in the fund. Mr Deputy Speaker, other allocations have been made to departments to meet a range of pressures. These include £2 million to the Department of Agriculture and Rural Development for the Going for Growth strategy and the Department's HQ relocation, £2 million to the Department of Culture, Arts and Leisure to deal with pressures relating to Northern Ireland Screen, Cinemagic, Prony and the production of the outlined business case for the sub-regional stadia, £5 million for the Department for Regional Development for TransLink Town bus services and road repair programmes, £1.9 million to the Department of the Environment for the Local Government derating grant, £3.1 million for the Department of Social Development to reinstate reductions applied to the Social Fund and to fund the National Citizen Service, and £1.5 million to OFM-DFM for Victims Services. I want to particularly highlight the allocation of £10 million for Together Building a United Community. This funding will be held centrally and will be allocated as part of the June monitoring round to projects that will help the Executive deliver on its commitment to improve community relations and build a united and shared society. Mr Deputy Speaker, whilst it is undoubtedly the case that our budget is in better shape because of the financial package associated with the Stormont House agreement between the Executive parties on welfare reform, and Barnett consequentials flowing from the Chancellor's autumn statement, it does not mean that the challenges facing public spending in Northern Ireland have evaporated. At the time of the draft budget, I warned that pressure on public expenditure would inevitably result in a change to the shape and nature of our public sector. That remains true. Despite our ability as an executive to allocate in this final budget an additional £150 million of funding over and above the allocations in the draft budget, with a resultant drop in resource spending of only £60 million next year, it would be a misjudgment to believe that we can take our foot off the pedal of reform. A better budget than we might have dared to imagine 6 months ago does not mean that difficult decisions can be avoided. Reform and restructuring remain as relevant now as they did before. As indicated at draft budget stage, the Executive will shortly adopt a comprehensive programme of public sector reform and restructuring, which will encompass a wide range of strategies. The Executive continue to consider the detail of this reform and restructuring plan, but it builds upon the five Executive parties' submission to Her Majesty's Government during the recent Stormont House negotiations, which outlined our agreement to reduce the public sector workforce in Northern Ireland by 20,000 posts over the next 4 years through a combination of measures such as a voluntary exit scheme and recruitment freezes. The flexibilities agreed in the Stormont House agreement to utilise up to £200 million of RRI borrowing to pay for a voluntary exit scheme in 2015-16 will greatly assist the Executive in our aims and will yield an estimated £500 million annual saving to our budget after the available £700 million has been invested by 2018-19. The Executive has also agreed the January monitoring round for 2014-2015. The Assembly knows only too well how demanding this year has been for our budget. In-year resource reductions of 4.4% for all departments except health and education were needed, along with a call on the reserve of £100 million in order to try to live within our means. We exited the October monitoring round with a £24.7 million resource deal and a £12.8 million capital deal over commitment, meaning that the risk of breaching our budget was still very real. A number of adjustments have impacted upon our financial position. A budget exchange scheme adjustment in 2014-15 based on the recently determined 2013-14 final outturn position. This showed an additional underspend in 2013-14 of 4.1% resource deal, thereby providing additional funding in 2014-15. On capital deal, the underspend was £0.1 million less, creating a small pressure. The Chancellor's autumn statement provided Barnet consequences for 2014-15 of £0.8 million resource deal and £0.8 million capital deal. I've also recently been notified that the Executive will receive a Barnet consequential amounting to £10.9 million as a result of the Chancellor of the Exchequer's announcement of a freeze to council tax in England in 2014-15. The latest regional rate forecast indicated that income in this year is expected to be £0.5 million less than was anticipated at the October monitoring round, creating a pressure to be addressed in this round. There have also been a number of small easements in respect of RRI borrowing interest payments, EU match funding, statutory salaries and cash management charges amounting to £5.1 million resource deal and £2.4 million capital deal. Mr. Deputy Speaker, the impact of these changes was to reduce the starting over commitment for the January monitoring round to £4.4 million of resource deal and £9.7 million in respect of capital deal. Departments declared reduced requirements in this monitoring round of £30.5 million resource deal and £40.4 million capital deal. Full details are included in the tables provided. This monitoring round also provides the last opportunity for adjustments to the schools and further education end-year flexibility schemes. On the schools EYF scheme, I can confirm that the Department of Education has not declared any adjustment to the £5 million resource deal drawn down under the terms of this scheme back in the June monitoring round. As a consequence, the schools EYF stock carried into 15-16 will be £41.7 million. There has been no drawdown in 2014 under the restricted end-year flexibility scheme for further education colleges. In addition, the Department of Employment and Learning has advised that as part of the current monitoring round that it plans to add £8.3 million to this stock. As a consequence, the FE College EYF stock carried forward into 15-16 will be £14.3 million. Mr. Deputy Speaker, a number of internal reallocations agreed by the Executive in this monitoring round are included in the tables accompanying this statement for information. The Executive also agreed a number of reclassifications between the resource and capital categories in this round. There were also reclassifications between the ring-fenced and non-ring-fenced resource deal categories. These reclassifications are also shown in the tables. All of the above issues impacted on the amount of resources available to the Executive in this monitoring round. Taking into account the starting position, the reduced requirements and reclassifications resulted in £28.1 million of resource deal and £23.2 million capital deal being available to the Executive. Mr. Speaker, or Deputy Speaker, against the available resources, the Department submitted bids amounting to £62.4 million in respect of resource deal and £48.3 million in terms of capital deal. These bids are also detailed in the tables. Before coming to the allocations agreed, I would also like to update members on the position in relation to ring-fenced financial transactions capital funding. Members will recall that this funding can only be used for the purpose of providing loans to or equity investment in the private sector. Following the October monitoring round, some £35.2 million of financial transactions capital remained unallocated. However, due to delay in the implementation of the GP and dentist loan scheme, the Department for Health has surrendered £5 million in this round. In addition, slippage in the Northern Ireland Science Park development has resulted in DEDI declaring a reduced requirement of £0.4 million. This now leaves £40.6 million available for allocation. My officials have been working closely with departments to identify schemes that could use this type of funding. As a result of this work, I am pleased to announce that the Executive agreed to provide £38.5 million funding of financial transactions capital funding to the Ulster University to assist in financing their Greater Belfast Development Scheme. This is in addition to the £35 million previously provided. This is a strategically significant project for the City of Belfast and indeed the whole of Northern Ireland, and I believe it is important that the Executive has demonstrated its continued support through provision of this additional financing. The Executive has also agreed to allocate £2.1 million of ring-fenced financial transactions capital to Derry to support their growth loan fund. Following these allocations, all of the financial transactions capital funding available to the Executive this year has now been allocated. Mr Deputy Speaker, the Executive agreed allocations totalling £14.2 million in terms of resource sale and £27.2 million in respect of capital sale. These allocations are detailed in the tables and I will only highlight a few of the main ones. On the resource sale side, there is £0.6 million to decal for sporting events and to help save the Ulster Orchestra. Derry will receive £2.2 million to meet pressures in Invest NI and the Northern Ireland Tourist Board. DRD will receive £5.2 million for street lighting and roads maintenance. And OFM-DFM will receive £4.5 million to support the Delivering Social Change programme and the Victims and Survivors Service. In respect of Capital Dale, allocations include DSD receiving £7 million for investment in the social housing stock. The Department of Education will receive £5.4 million towards the purchase of a school site and to provide for updating of schools' IT equipment under the C2K programme. £6.4 million to DFP to advance our asset management strategy. £3 million to DRD for road structural maintenance. And DHSS PS will receive £3.3 million for investment in medical equipment, ICT and health and safety. In relation to the Delivering Social Change programme, members will have noted that the Executive has agreed a £3.2 million resource Dale allocation in this round. This has been supplemented by £2.1 million of funding identified by OFM-DFM, who have confirmed the following allocations under the Delivering Social Change programme to be processed in this monitoring round. £0.8 million to DHSS PS for the Family Support and Parenting Support programmes. £2.6 million to the Department of Education for Literacy and Numeracy programme. £1.9 million to DSD for Nurture Units and the Social Enterprise programme. And £0.02 million to DOE for the Play and Leisure programme. These transactions totalling £5.3 million will be handled as technical transfers rather than allocations. Following these transactions, no centrally held funding relating to the Social Investment Fund, Delivering Social Change programme or Childcare Strategy remains unallocated in this year. Mr Deputy Speaker, the Executive now exits the January monitoring round with £13.9 million in terms of resource expenditure unallocated. Whilst on capital investment, there is an overcommitment of £4 million. I believe this level of capital investment overcommitment is perfectly manageable given historic patterns of underspend. I very much hope that the £13.9 million resource expenditure unallocated can be carried forward under the budget exchange scheme to help address pressures in 2015-16. However, members should note that the Minister for Regional Development has indicated that his department is likely to overspend on resource Dale in the current year, with the latest estimate of the pressure amounting to £13 million. The potential overspend is a consequence of the Minister's failure to address in full the £20 million gap in his budget as a consequence of value not being released from Belfast Port as planned at the time of the last budget. The DRD Minister has been aware of this pressure for some time, and he should have taken the actions necessary to address it at the start of the financial year. It is absolutely unacceptable for ministers to manage their budgets on the expectation of additional funding being secured through the Executive's in-year monitoring process. To offset the risk that an overspend by DRD will cause the Northern Ireland Executive to exceed its HM Treasury control total on resource Dale, the Executive has agreed not to allocate £13.9 million resource expenditure in this round. I intend to closely monitor the financial position across departments over the remaining months of this financial year to ensure that carry forward of funding under the budget exchange scheme is maximised and that no funding is lost to Northern Ireland. Executive colleagues have agreed to cooperate fully in this task. Mr Deputy Speaker, given the significant challenges that have faced the Executive's resource sale in 2014-15 year, I am pleased to report that the Executive is now on course to live within its Her Majesty's Treasury control totals this year. There is, Mr Deputy Speaker, no such thing as the perfect budget, but in the challenging circumstances this Executive found itself, this represents a good deal for the people of Northern Ireland. US Treasury Secretary Jack Lew once said that the budget is not just a collection of numbers, but an expression of our values and aspirations. This budget aims to mirror the values and aspirations of the people of Northern Ireland. It is a budget that deals with many of our pressures, reflects our priorities and prepares for the future. It is a budget that underpins the economic growth Northern Ireland has been experiencing and prepares us for the devolution of corporation tax with sizeable investments in job creation and skills development. It is a budget that prioritises our key public services with over £200 million more for health and a significant uplift for education compared to the draft budget position. It is a budget that puts us on the path to reforming and restructuring our public sector in readiness for what will be tough times ahead. And above all, it is a budget and a January monitoring round for the people of Northern Ireland, keeping rates down, maintaining household taxes at the lowest levels in the whole of the United Kingdom, retaining supports like concessionary fares for the elderly, and still investing in necessary everyday public services like health, schools and street lighting. Mr. Deputy Speaker, over the past year or more, budgetary, financial and welfare reform issues have been the cause of much disharmony and division within this Assembly. There were times when I thought that the Executive might breach its budget or that agreement on a budget for next year would prove impossible. A budget is the cornerstone upon which any government programme is built. Without an agreed budget, no administration can function. With some imagination, some innovation, some compromise and, above all, a lot of effort and endeavour, we have found a way through our immediate problems. This budget agreeing a way forward for next year with a focus on key frontline public services and aiding economic growth and pointing the way towards reform and restructuring represents an opportunity at the beginning of a new year for a fresh start for this Assembly and Executive. Let no one be in any doubt, whilst the budget I present today is infinitely better for our public services and for our economy than we could have hoped for, tough times lie ahead. In many respects, the most difficult decisions on public spending have yet to come. No one wants cuts, but I believe that in agreeing this budget, we have done the right thing. We have accepted the realities facing us and have done what we can to protect and support what is important to our people. Tough choices and difficult decisions was how I characterised this budget. Mr. Deputy Speaker, it would seem that they were too tough and too difficult for some. Opposition is easy. Saying no when you know that you don't need to say yes is hardly tough or difficult. But those who fail to find the courage to back this budget, those who took a narrow departmental or party political view, those who call for compromise only to vote against because they didn't get their own way, and those who want to adopt the cynical position of claiming clean hands on cuts while all the time remaining in the executive, they have, Mr. Deputy Speaker, exposed their inability to lead in challenging times. Anyone can vote for more money when times are good. It takes real leadership to say yes when the decisions are difficult. Those who say no to this budget are well within their rights to do so. But the people of Northern Ireland need to know this. When challenged to come forward with alternative proposals to the budget presented to them, those ministers who voted no said nothing. Happy to criticise, Mr. Deputy Speaker, but not so keen to produce credible alternatives. Mr. Deputy Speaker, sometimes I think we forget the degree of progress that we've made. Today we enjoy a degree of peace and political stability denied to several previous generations. Contrary to the criticism from some quarters, this executive has achieved much. Devolution has allowed us to transform Northern Ireland into somewhere that is a magnet for international investment. We are increasingly a venue for world-renowned events. Locally elected politicians in this place have been able to pursue policies that are in the interests of our people. Policies like keeping household taxes low, prioritising health and education, and securing the power to lower the rate of corporation tax. Agreeing this budget was as big a test as any our administration has passed since the restoration of devolution. No budget would have meant no Stormont. It may not be ideal or to everyone's satisfaction, but agreeing it in the context of severe pressures on public spending represents a sign of growing maturity. It should act as a stimulus as we step into a future full of challenge. Let us use this agreed budget with its focus on public services, the economy and reform to renew and redouble our efforts to make progress and keep Northern Ireland moving forward. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I commend this the Executive's agreed budget for 2015-16 to the House. Yeah.
Order. Before we move to the first question, I wish to inform the House that the Speaker has agreed to a request from the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Development to reschedule the ministerial statement on the outcome of the December Fisheries Council 214 to Tuesday the 20th of January. Revisited indicative timings will be issued accordingly. Now, before I call the first questioner, can I inform the House there's a very large number of members who have put their names down to ask questions, and I'm sure members agree with me that as many members as possible should be allowed to do that. For that reason, can I ask members to ensure that your question, and I emphasise question, is brief, and also that your question relates to the ministerial statement. I call Mr. Dati Mackay, Chairperson of the Finance Committee.
Can I welcome this statement? This is quite clearly good news for our schools, it's good news for our universities, and good news for health. And also, can I welcome the fact that this place is taking a cut as well, because I think the public think that the Assembly and ourselves should feel some pain in terms of the budget for the year ahead. Minister, the DRD Minister has often alleged that you're threatening to knock his lights out. So can I welcome the £2 million that is going towards street lighting? But do you agree that it is not sustainable for opposition ministers to want to have their cake and eat it every time that they mismanage their own budgets? And would he also agree that it's not MLAs that need training courses? Perhaps it's some of the ministers that act like cuckoos within the executive that need some training.
Can I thank the chairman for his welcome for the budget, and I look forward to working with him and indeed the committee over the next number of weeks, because the announcement of an agreement of a budget and the announcement of it in this House is only the start of a process which will take us through most of February, and I look forward to working with the committee in respect of that. I think there has been a particular problem has arisen in the Department for Regional Development, and it would seem that whatever the issue, whatever the problem, the Minister for Regional Development wants to make it everybody else's problem instead of getting on with doing his job, which is looking after his budget and taking the difficult decisions which we all have to take within his budget. He entered this year knowing that there was £20 million of a pressure, and there's a whole history as to why that pressure is there, and I could argue, as I'm sure colleagues would argue, that the Minister and the Department didn't act vigorously enough in trying to pursue value from the port. That, of course, hasn't materialised, resulting in any pressure. But no Minister should behave at the start of the year as if they have more money in their budget than they actually have. You should not, as a Minister, be spending to a budget line which is inflated by, in his case, by £20 million, and then come to the Executive in year and expect that pressure to be met. And if we go back in time, we go back to the October monitoring round, we exited that, as I highlighted in my statement, with an overcommitment on the resource side of nearly £25 million. And there was a very real risk that the Executive as a whole could breach its budget, and that would have been an unacceptable and untenable position to be in. The bid made by the Minister for Regional Development could not at that time be made. But whether it could be made or couldn't be made is immaterial. I cannot have, as my responsibility as guardian of the public finances, go to the Executive and ask for the Executive's agreement to support ministers who have behaved irresponsibly in the management of their budget. That simply is not acceptable. I have to be careful. If I was to do that, that would not be setting a dangerous precedent. So I wasn't prepared to go down that route. And in terms of dealing with those pressures within the Department, the Minister has known for a long time that he's had pressures within that Department, has failed to take decisive action early enough. And you only have to look at the situation where there is £20 million worth of port pressure. He was bidding for £18 million to address that in the January monitoring round, knowing way back at the start of the year that he had that pressure, and he is only taking out costs, supposedly, of £2 million. It doesn't show, in my view, decisive or quick enough action on the part of the Roads Minister to deal with a problem that he knew he had right from the start of the financial year.
Members, I have allowed some latitude to the chairman of the committee. does not apply to anyone else. And while I would not in any way curtail the minister's responses, it would be helpful too if they could be brief. I call Mr. Peter Weir.
And I congratulate the minister on his statement. And in the interest of brevity, can I ask the minister, does he believe that the £30 million that have been set aside for the change fund will be successful?
In the interest of brevity, Deputy Speaker, I'm tempted just to say yes. Well, I think it has. I think the fact that the change fund, which had been set aside in the draft budget to encourage bids by ministers for reform-orientated, innovative projects, cross-departmental collaborative projects, and also for early intervention and prevention work, has been vindicated by the fact, Deputy Speaker, that there was over five times subscription for the funds, and obviously we had to run that through a process. And I think you will see from the tables that are attached to the statement that virtually every department has succeeded in one way or another. Now, we will have to examine whether there is utility for this moving forward. My argument would be that, particularly in times whenever money is less and pressure is increasing, that is exactly the sort of time where you want to devote more of your resources, or as much as you possibly can, to being innovative, to being reform-orientated, to working across departments to deal with very difficult problems, and also to focus on early intervention and prevention. So it's certainly, I think, something that was worthwhile, and I think the members will see from the bids that were met that some very good bids were agreed to, and I think it may be something that is worthwhile looking by the executive at for the future as well.
Call Mr. Dominic Bradley.
And what I welcome about this statement by the minister is his Damascus-like conversion, because he had previously told us there is no more money available, there's no point in talking to the British government. Yes. Well, he has spoken to them, and all the parties have spoken to them, and apparently there is. So I'm glad he's taken his lead from the SDLP. Mr. Deputy Speaker, my question to the Minister is in relation to the additional money to education. And I would like to ask him, can he tell us, will the money go to frontline services, especially to ensure that children with special educational needs, children with literacy and numeracy difficulties, that the services to them will be maintained, and that pupil-teacher ratios will remain at the level which they're at now? Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, if I'd listened to the SDLP when it comes to financial advice, I'd now probably be arrested for trying to sell the city of Derry Airport, which doesn't belong to the Northern Ireland Executive. So I'll not listen to his party's advice. No one ever said that there was never going to be more money. What we made clear, and what I made clear, and colleagues made clear, is there was going to be no more money for welfare reform, and that is the case. Barring the consequentials flowing from decisions taken by the Chancellor, taken by government in Westminster, always flow, always come. So there is always additional money, sometimes small, sometimes medium, sometimes large. In this case, it has been incredibly beneficial to the executive and has eased a lot of the pressure, not least in education, which the member has outlined. And I think that given the very serious, significant campaign that was levied over the last number of weeks, the executive does expect the Minister for Education to use the allocation, sizeable allocation of £63 million that he has received, which of course the member's own minister within the executive voted against. So he welcomes it here today, sends his colleague into the executive last week to vote against an allocation of £63 million in additional funding for education. And the executive, like the community, would expect the minister will use that sizeable allocation, which is over a third of all of the available additional funding, to go to ease those pressures in the classroom, which so many of us have heard about through principals and boards of governors within our own constituencies.
Call Mr. Leslie Cree.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his many, many figures. I'd like to have had them a little bit sooner than just this morning. Minister, three points, if you could answer them very quickly. They refer to novel switches, for example, resource to Dell, resource to capital, Northern Ireland Investment Fund, you know, the transactions capital. Have all those issues now been approved by Treasury and therefore can be used again on the time going forward?
I think the member may be a little confused in terms of, Deputy Speaker, in terms of where switches were taking place between capital and resource and resource and capital. We've been switching and we have agreed. We have received agreement now flowing from the Stormont House agreement to switch capital into resource to pay off the £100 million claim on the reserve this year so that we could live within our means, and we are also able to use, we have the flexibility now to use capital to pay off the £114 million welfare penalty, which unfortunately is still there for next year. In respect of the Northern Ireland Investment Fund, work continues in respect of that. We're just about to appoint a consultant who will work up various business plans and operating plans and so forth, and that has received approval from Treasury. Before we commit to any of these FTC schemes, we go to Treasury to ensure that it lives within the rules that they have, or it meets the rules that they have, and this one does. So very, very pleased that we have been able to increase the allocation to the investment fund to some £40 million, which won't all be spent in the next financial year, but will be invested over several years as we leverage in an estimated up to a total of £1 billion worth of funding for infrastructure projects in the energy and housing sectors and other sectors as well.
Call Mrs. Judith Cochrane.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. The budget is balanced on a 100% cuts basis, and most other governments would never consider that approach. And indeed, the OECD recommends a 70-30 split between spending cuts and revenue raising. Would the Minister agree with the OECD recommendations and also with me that the current approach is unsustainable and that the Executive needs to consider fair and progressive revenue raising so as to prevent deeper cuts to our public services, which ultimately will affect our most vulnerable?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I mean, I commend the bravery of the Alliance Party in continuing to be a party who wants to see household taxes increase in Northern Ireland. I'm very, very proud of the fact that since restoration of devolution in 2007, the Executive has maintained our record as having the lowest household taxes in the UK. And I think that reflects, I think it's right that the pressures that people and householders and businesses in Northern Ireland are facing, that we do continue, insofar as we can, to maintain that policy. And I'm very, very pleased with the fact that even though this has been a very challenging and a very, very difficult budget, that we have been able to do that. And the Alliance Party are probably a lone voice in some respects in wanting to see revenue raising increased in Northern Ireland. And that's, you know, terms like revenue raising are used almost euphemistically, Deputy Speaker, but what they mean are tax increases. And that's what the Alliance Party are proposing at a time of real pressure on households and businesses. What the Alliance Party do here in this House, and indeed their ministers last week in the Executive, called for the introduction of water charges, they called for significant increases in the regional rate, and they called for the elimination of schemes such as concessionary fares for the elderly. Now, I would encourage the Alliance Party over the next number of months in particular to go out and tell the people of Northern Ireland that they are in favour of water charges, that they are in favour of an increase in the regional rate, and they are in favour, as their ministers outlined last week, at looking at schemes like concessionary fares. And what I can say, Deputy Speaker, is if the Alliance Party don't remind the people of Northern Ireland that they are their policies, we sure as hell will.
Call Mr. Gregory Campbell.
Deputy Speaker, can I thank the Minister for his statement? It would appear, given what he has said, that there still will be significant challenges across a range of departments, but specifically in relation to agriculture and rural development. Can the Finance Minister confirm that the procedure for the relocation of the Dard headquarters will be able to proceed on schedule, which up until a few weeks ago, both yourself, Deputy Speaker, and others were fully in support of?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I don't deny that, I would never deny this, that there are still going to be difficult decisions going to have to be made by all ministers. Actually, even those ministers who, on the face of it, if you look at the table that is contained within the statement, there are some ministers who will see their departmental allocations increase in percentage terms next year. And those departments will still be facing a degree of pressures and will have to cut back on some of the things that they deliver. Dard is probably one of the, in a budget which has reductions for most departments, it's one of those who are, I suppose, not doing as badly as others with a reduction of 4%. I met with the Agriculture Minister just a couple of weeks ago and talked through a range of issues that her department was facing. It was a very productive meeting, and I'm pleased that we were able to make a further allocation to the departments, about £1 million to the department's relocation for the department's relocation to Ballykelly. And while there are obviously serious personnel issues that have to be worked through in terms of those staff who are in Dundonald House, and that has to be treated with the greatest of sensitivity, I'm happy to support the relocation to Ballykelly in the way that we have. And I have heard some parties in this House, represented in this House, indeed represented in the Executive, claim that ending the relocation to Ballykelly would somehow be the panacea that would solve all of our budgetary problems. Well, as the member will know, and the House should know, the significant cost at the outset is a capital cost. Now, we could always do with more capital money, but capital is not where the real pressure are next year. That is in the resource side of the budget. The cost to move to Ballykelly is around £27 million, I understand. The cost to refurbish Dundonald House, which is a building which is on its last legs and does need to be refitted, would be around £22-23 million. So the saving, such as it is on capital, would be less than £5 million. Now, we are dealing with a budget problem, which is not a capital problem per se, but a resource problem. And £4 million of capital is not going to solve all of our budget problems. And I'm happy to support the policy, which will be one that I think is welcomed widely across the members' constituency and indeed in neighbouring constituencies too.
Call Ms. Maeve McLaughlin.
I thank the Minister for his statement today. Can I welcome, Minister, the £204 million allocation to health, and I think particularly the additional focus on the All-Ireland Children's Heart Services model to be welcomed. I note the Minister has said that he's committed to assessing performance in health and particularly progressing a health sector review. And given your own comments, Minister, in relation to the mismanagement of the health budget, maybe you could clarify to the House just where that mismanagement of the budget lies, and also, if I may, in relation to the unallocated money in the January monitoring round, could the Minister indicate his commitment to the expansion of the University at McGee?
It's an eclectic bunch of questions, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I'm very pleased to be able to increase the allocation to the Department of Health by £204 million. Next year, which represents a 3.5% roughly percent increase in its allocation compared to this year. The Health Minister, if he was here, would be the first to say that he would have taken much more in terms of allocations than £204 million, and I would have liked to, in different circumstances, have been able to give more money to health. But it is important that with such a significant allocation, which is close to 50% of our total resource expenditure next year, will go to the Department of Health alone. That money is going where it needs to go. And it is also important that the budget spends within its plans, because even though it has got that 3.5% increase, there will be pressures. It is important, therefore, that it lives within its means, as indeed all departments should be living within their means. I am confident that the work that was undertaken by the department and the minister subsequent to last year has ensured that there is greater control at the centre over the trusts and what they are spending on a day-to-day basis. My department, in the outset, will monitor its plans to ensure that they are robust and they are deliverable. But in the longer term, we have engaged, as the House will know, the OECD to carry out a wider review of the public sector in Northern Ireland. And one of the case studies that we have now identified for them to look at is health in Northern Ireland. So it will take a longer-term view at what we are doing, benchmark that against other OECD member states, and I think that's a useful opportunity with the OECD here and their history and their record of working with Northern Ireland on education and some projects taken forward by OFM, DFM. I think it's a useful opportunity to use that expertise and that international benchmarking to judge where we are and where we need to go.
I need to remind members, please, it's one brief question. I call Ms. Michelle McElveen.
Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the Minister's statement and delighted that the Minister has listened to the concerns of the education sector. And we also seek assurance that the £63 million allocation to the Department of Education actually goes to the aggregated schools budget. But could I also ask the Minister what alternatives those voting against the budget had to ease the pressures in education? That was only one question.
To answer the second subpart of the member's question, the answer is a simple one. There were no alternatives put forward. Whilst I heard a lot of, and I followed the debate that the member brought to the House last week in respect of education budgets and trying to get as much of the budget, which I agree with, to get it into the front line, which we'd all define as the classroom. I listened to all parties in this House call for that to be the case and for increases in expenditure on education. Whenever we got to the executive last week and the paper was put in £63 million, which I'm sure, that, again, like all ministers, the minister sitting opposite would have taken more if it had been available, but I'm sure he would accept in the circumstances it is a generous and significant increase in compared to his draft budget position. I heard all parties call for more money, which is what we did, but then the three smaller parties in the executive all proceeded to vote against it without putting forward a single alternative suggestion as to how we might find more money or where we may take money from to get more to education or more to health or whatever it might be. I've received correspondence from the Education Minister this morning which confirms an additional £80 million will be allocated to the aggregated schools budget in next year. The preschool provision will see its funding restored to ensure that the PFG commitment can be delivered, and then an additional £2 million over the draft budget figure will be allocated to the Education and Library Board's youth services. So it's obviously worth the member in her committee capacity taking that forward with the Minister as to where he will be prioritising from within his own budget. But I think that we can see from the £63 million additional allocation and decisions taken by the Education Minister himself that the aggregated schools budget and therefore the schools front line of education being the classroom is being protected as best we can in very difficult circumstances.
Call Ms. Rosie McCarley.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the Minister's statement today. The Minister has stated that funding for Regent Stadia has been returned. Could I just please ask him to confirm if funds for Casement Park's redevelopment will be available in the future?
Mr Deputy Speaker, I made it clear in my statement, I made it clear to the executive last week that we understand the circumstances as to why the Regional Stadia project, particularly the Casement Park project, can't proceed at this time. It remains an executive commitment to invest in Casement Park just as we have invested in Windsor Park and invested in Ravenhill as well. And what I have committed to and the executive has agreed and I've outlined again today is that should it be required, so if a successful planning application proceeds, I will favourably look upon and meet any in-year capital bids for the Casement Park and other stadia projects. There is also money allocated to the DECAL Minister to allow her to proceed with outlined business cases for the regional, sub-regional stadia. So whilst there's not perhaps the allocation there that would disappoint many, the commitment is there to fulfil the other commitment that the executive have made to take forward that project.
Call Mr Pat Ramsey.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for presenting his paper today. The Minister made a very broad statement when he was speaking that unemployment is falling. And I'm sure the Minister would agree to me that there was many in the North West, including your own Deputy Speaker, will resent and be angered by that. In light of the executive decision to set up a small executive group to look at regional balance, particularly the North West, could the Minister outline to the House the importance to ensure that that is resourced effectively to make a difference?
Sorry, again, a sense of deja vu. Look, I accept that whilst our economy is improving, and it is improving across Northern Ireland as a whole, and unemployment is falling, and whilst I accept that the economy is doing better, that there are areas which could be doing even better, and I accept that the North West has a legacy of particular issues which we are still working through and will prove difficult to resolve but require effort on all of our parts, not just the executive but also the private sector and the others as well. But you know, I think to resent the fact that unemployment as a whole across Northern Ireland is falling, I think it's something that the member and his party might wish to reflect on. Unemployment across Northern Ireland is falling. There are more people getting into work. The member sits and shakes his head. It is a verifiable fact produced independently by NISRA, that unemployment in Northern Ireland is going down. It is going down. And that is a good thing. What we as an executive, what we as a society need to now do is to ensure as best as we can that the benefits of economic growth are felt as far and wide across Northern Ireland. And there has been an undoubted commitment on behalf of this executive to Londonderry, to the North West, whether it be from the City of Culture, whether it be in trying to attract, and we can't force investors to invest anywhere, but we have tried to encourage as best we can people to go to the North West, and that's been manifested in a number of significant FDI projects and indeed the expansion of Indigenous companies in that area. We've brought the first enterprise zone in Northern Ireland, is located in the North West as well. So there have been many things that this executive have pursued to assist and support that area. And it is time, Mr. Deputy Speaker, if I might say, for, and the member looks and looks for more money. And he sits and asks for more money. He asks for more money, knowing the budget that we have, when his party votes against that budget and comes forward with not a single alternative which would help me or all our executive colleagues to find more money or to where we might reprioritise from within existing budgets. And if I might say, Mr. Deputy Speaker, it is a part of Northern Ireland which has seen a lot of attention, and I wouldn't deny that it deserves that attention and does require continued attention. But there are other parts of Northern Ireland as well who have suffered in different ways down through the years, continue to have particular problems, who would love a fraction of the executive's attention that it has given to the northwest of Northern Ireland.
Call Mr. Danny Kinahan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and thank the Minister for his statement, and particularly for the monies going to education, and I'm glad that we're hearing that they're going to the front line. But my question is in regards to the D of E capital budget. Would the Minister explain why exactly there's a £50 million FTC funding allocated for the ARC 21 project? If it commences, when his party, especially locally, seem to be against it, especially are now, and what exactly is his party's position on the ARC 21?
My position on ARC 21 is quite simple. I'm quite happy for councils in the east of Northern Ireland to come together to work on waste management issues. That's quite easy to give an opinion on. In respect of the particular allocation of FTC to this project, this isn't a project that has been taken forward by me or my department. The member will know that there is £160 million roughly of an allocation of FTC in the next financial year. Given our experience in this year where we struggled, and I'm happy to admit that, we struggled to spend the £60 million allocation, we are obviously looking for a lot of larger projects to soak up that cash next year. This allocation comes on the basis of work that was done between the Department of the Environment and the Strategic Investment Board to develop this project, or to have input into this project, and it was their assessment that it would be one that could be supported by financial transactions capital. In some senses, it's an indicative allocation to it because, of course, as the member will know, no planning permission has been granted for this scheme yet. So there is a degree of risk in terms of making this allocation that the project doesn't go forward for whatever particular reason. And I made that clear to the Environment Minister actually at negotiations around the draft budget that irrespective of what allocation he received, however that came, if there was a reason that the project could not proceed, I wouldn't expect him to find a project to spend the money that has been allocated to his department. So obviously, like all projects, it depends very much on planning permission and other legalities that got through. But it is one that has been taken forward, and I reiterate this point, at the behest of the Environment Minister and the Strategic Investment Board, who developed their input into it.
Call Mr. Paul Girvan.
Thank the Minister for his statement to the House, and appreciate that it's up to each Minister as to how they break up and prioritise their budget within their own departments. In light of the comments made, is it necessary to proceed with the voluntary exit scheme in light of such a close proximity of the spend between this year and last year, so there's very little difference?
Superficially, Mr. Deputy Speaker, it might look to, you know, while we continue to talk about the need to reform and restructure our public sector in lots of different ways, and the main aspect of that being a fairly large voluntary exit scheme, which we now have the flexibility to fund to the tune of £200 million next year. The executive has agreed to do that. It might look, when you look at these numbers, which are more or less in cash terms, the same as they were for next year as compared to what they are this year, that pressure to do that has lifted. It hasn't, both in the short and the long term. The executive in this assembly needs to remain focused on reform and restructuring because next year there are some departments which are doing better than others, and perhaps the pressure has eased from them somewhat, but there are some departments, including my own, who are still facing reductions of close to 10% or around 10%. So for those departments, they will still, in terms of making savings, have to reduce the headcount within their departments. Therefore, a voluntary exit scheme which will realise some savings next year but make more savings in future years is absolutely essential for those departments. None of us knows what the future holds in terms of what the budget is, but the Office of Budget Responsibility projections are that times are going to get tougher and tighter. So therefore, even those departments who may think they're doing better now will still probably need to access a voluntary exit scheme this year to plan for future years as well. And it is very much that look to the future where we know that we have difficulties coming down the track that we need to be concentrated on in continuing to reform and restructure our public sector.
Call Mr. Ian McCree.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and I too welcome the Minister's statement to the House today. In the this blue budget booklet that the Minister has released, he refers to $53.3 million of funding being allocated to the Community Safety College at Desert Crete. Can the Minister outline what stage that process is at, and what future funding is required to take it forward? And does he feel that it is rank hypocrisy of those who didn't support the budget who may call for the finances to be made available for it?
Yeah. There's lots of hypocritical positions have been taken in respect of this budget. And by the way, Mr. I think this is teal rather than blue document, yeah. But we'll not argue over that. In respect of Desert Crete, I know it's a project, the Community Safety College in Desert Crete is a project dear to the member's heart. I know that there is a lot of, I've been accused of pedantry by Mr. Campbell here, and he's probably right. The Desert Crete Community Safety College is something that has, I know, frustrated, because the member and I have spoken about it several times. It is an issue that its non-movement has frustrated him, as indeed it has frustrated other elected representatives, indeed the wider community in the Middle Cirque area. It is still allocated in the Department of Justice's capital budget for next year, but he and I both know that there is work required in terms of the size and scale of any project that might be taken forward. On that site, the executive remains committed to its commitment to locate Community Safety College in that area. But obviously, there's a work that has to be done across a range of departments, and health, and the Department of Justice, primary amongst those, to make sure that continues in whatever guise or whatever shape that it is. And it does still require, Deputy Speaker, flexibility to be given by Treasury to accessing the funding that has been sitting there on a flexible basis over the last number of years, so that that can be spent on that project if indeed it needs to go forward in the next financial year.
Call Mr. Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The Minister, in speaking today, told the House that, that other Ministers were not so keen to provide credible alternatives. But would the Minister not simply agree with me that his budget could have been substantially more brave when it came to revenue raising? We're not just talking about water charges. We're talking about constituents who tell me that they are willing, in circumstances, to pay for prescription charges, that they are willing to forgo their bus passes. The reality is that this minister is stripping away jobs from Dard and from East Belfast.
Can I please plead with members to ask brief questions and not to be making statements?
I don't think there was even a question there, Deputy Speaker. But look, you know, I'm content, as I said to the member's colleague. I am very, very happy, very content for the Alliance Party, if they wish, to continue to help to characterise itself as a high-tax party. That's what it is. That's what it is coming forward with. That's what its suggestions are. It wants water charges at a cost of probably £400 to £500 to hit every household in Northern Ireland. It wants to see rates bills increase significantly. It wants to see things like concessionary fare scheme disappear. So you know that's what the Alliance Party, in terms of, and to be fair, I mean I've been critical of other parties for not coming forward with an alternative. Of the three parties in the executive who voted against, at least the Alliance Party did come forward with an alternative. I've said over the last number of days that this budget is not a perfect budget, and it is certainly not the budget that I would have brought forward had it been up to me. But at least we know that if it had been up to just the Alliance Party, it would have been a budget that would have been built upon water charges and higher rates and the end of schemes like concessionary fares.
Call Mr. Alistair Ross.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, the Minister has announced a £20 million allocation for the Department of Justice to be used for policing budgets. Can I ask the Minister, is that money to be specifically used for policing? And if it is, what pressures of the policing budget can be lifted because of the allocation he's made today?
Thank the member for his question, Deputy Speaker. It is specifically an allocation of a further £20 million for the PSNI budget as opposed to the whole of the Department of Justice, and it was deliberately so because there are other pressures, significant pressures, and the member will know his capacity as chair of the DOJ committee, particularly around legal aid. And it's not that I don't recognise that the Minister for Justice has a pressure in respect of legal aid, and whether we like the idea of spending more on legal aid than the rest of the United Kingdom or not, it is still a monetary pressure that his department faces, and it does need to be dealt with. And I'm supportive, and I have offered my support to the Minister in bringing forward means and measures that would deal with at least some of the pressures in respect of legal aid, and I'm sure the committee will hear that in due course. The allocation to the police comes from the Minister himself highlighting particular problems within the policing budget, and also the Chief Constable, who I met and outlined the pressures that his service and our service, I suppose, would face next year if it didn't get additional support. So I'm very happy to be able to allocate £20 million, and whilst it's not all that the Chief Constable was looking for, I think it was closer to sort of £27-28 million that he was looking for. He has assured me that it will allow him to continue with his plans for police recruitment next year, and also to ensure that some of the worst effects of reductions on the policing budget and how it affects people and public safety will certainly be lessened considerably.
Call Mr. Fergal McKinney.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and can I welcome the broad focus on protecting key public services, which, when it comes to health, the paper and the Minister's statement says there's an executive determination to protect frontline services. Would the Minister accept that that remains very ill-defined, and there's no better illustration of that than the arm's-length body, the NIFRS, the Northern Ireland Fire and Rescue Service, is excluded when it clearly performs a critical frontline role?
I think it's not an unreasonable point that the member makes. I think there's the Member's Party has an amendment down to debate later on this week in respect of this matter. Defining the frontline has been a difficult problem, and it will remain a difficult problem. And, you know, I think we all, in our own heads, understand what the frontline is, understand what core services are. There can be difficulties in terms of decoupling that completely with the need to have some degree of management and administration to make what happens in the front line, so whether that be in the classroom, whether that be in the hospital, or wherever that may be, actually happen. So I think it is difficult to define, but what this budget shows is that there is a commitment on the part of this executive to those key services that every single one of us and most of our constituents would judge as being key services, that being health with an additional £204 million and a boost of over £60 million for the education budget compared to its draft budget position. Of course, we would have liked to have seen more going into key services. We would like to see more going into the front line, however that is defined. But of course, our position was not helped, and I think I have made Mr. Deputy Speaker, in the face of very difficult circumstances, a good fist of it.
Call Mrs. Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I also note the Minister's optimism in regards to the allocation for health. But let's face reality. The health trusts have been ordered to make a further £113 million of cash releasing efficiencies and productivity gains next year. So can the Minister give a commitment that the scenes of earlier this year, when each of our trusts had to make the stringent in-year cuts to make emergency funding available, will not be repeated next year?
You know, the Health Minister would be the first to say that he would have liked to have more money coming out of this budget, but I think he understands, appreciates and is mature enough to realise that that's not possible, and I think he would, indeed he welcomed the extra £204 million that he has received, whilst acknowledging that he could have used more. I think it is not wrong for us to expect our trusts to continue to make efficiencies and savings on an ongoing basis, and I admire the fact that the current Minister and indeed his predecessor have, over the last 4 years, been able to release back into the front line of health close to £500 million worth through eroding efficiencies within the system. And I actually think it will behoves the member and indeed our party to come forward, as undoubtedly they will today and in future times as well, and demand more for health and that more be given to health, more money be given to health, whilst not coming forward in the executive where it matters with a single solitary alternative as to how we might finance health and find more money for health or education or whatever it might be. So whenever the member is criticising what we are giving to health in this budget, she needs to bear in mind that our own party, our own minister, did not come forward with an alternative proposal as to where money might be found, more money might be found for health.
Call Mr. Trevor Clark.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker. And can I thank the Minister for Finance in relation to his allocations towards town bus services, street lighting and road repairs. Can I ask the Minister if he's content that the allocations that he has made today that actually bizarrely haven't been supported by the Minister for Potholes and Broken Streetlights will bring about jobs, give security to the vulnerable and help to isolate it in rural towns?
I thank the member for his question, and I commend him on his work as chair of the Regional Development Committee and the job that he has been doing, along with other committee members, in exposing some of the waste and inefficiency within the Department for Regional Development, where we are told by the minister that there is untold pressures being faced so severe that the lights can't be kept on. I agree with the member. I think that there is what we should never forget in terms of the investments that are made into our roads infrastructure, sizeable investments made. Not just next year, but also in this year as well. Over the last 4 years, we have spent over £400 million in terms of our roads maintenance programmes, which includes, certainly in I think it was the year before last, a record single record investment for 1 year. That not only supports and provides, it supports our economy in terms of being able to get goods to the market much quicker. It helps people in local areas get about easier, but it also provides a boost for our economy through the employment that it brings to local firms who are doing that work. And I hope that some of the allocations that are made in the January monitoring and the allocations that are made for next year can continue to allow that to happen.
Call Mr. Tom Buchanan.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the Minister's announcement that no financial transactions capital will be lost this year due to a substantial allocation to the University of Ulster. But is the Minister satisfied that all departments are doing their best to ensure that this source of capital is utilised?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I join with the member in welcoming the allocation to the Ulster University of additional financial transactions capital. In some ways, whilst I welcome it, it is worrying at the same time. Not worrying in and of itself. I think it's a very, very good project, fantastic project. It will breathe renewed life back into that part of North Belfast, which will reap benefits for the whole of Belfast and the whole of Northern Ireland. What is worrying is that of our allocations of around £100 million of FTC over the last number of years, the university, or the Ulster University, as I need to get used to calling it now, will have accounted for close to three quarters of total FTC allocations. And clearly they are not going to, on a continual basis, require FTC to soak up this new source of capital that we have. That's why we created the investment fund, not just because it is a good thing to do, and absolutely it is a good thing to do in the longer term, but it is a vehicle in which we can spend FTC on an ongoing basis if it becomes available in year. I do think that other departments do need to come forward with more projects. A lot of the projects that have been taken forward have been because of the impetus and drive coming from my own department. There are some exceptions in terms of the departments. So Derry, for example, has been very good in bringing forward very small FTC-ready projects. Other departments need to step up to the plate. But also, Deputy Speaker, the private sector themselves, who are the very people for whom FTC was designed, also need to come forward with more projects. I've seen a few coming through the system that have been small in nature, but we need to see some of those bigger, particularly those regeneration projects, coming forward and seeking FTC as an option to finance their project.
Call Mr. Patsy McGlone.
Gorma Gilaskin, colleagues, Muihe Slishinera, Asin Ratchis, Gneed, Fijisha. Thanks very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her statement up until now. I heard his comments earlier around the extra allocations to education. And to come back to that point, will the Minister therefore guarantee that the pupil teacher ratios in schools will now be protected in light of that investment?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I have enough to do doing my own job. I'm not going to take on responsibility for the Education Minister, indeed for any other minister within the Executive. The £63 million allocation, which I was happy to propose, which the Members' Party voted against in the Executive last week, will go a long way to relieving a range of pressures, not least those pressures that are on the classroom. And as I outlined in response to Ms. McElveen and her question, the Education Minister has written to me today to outline how he is going to move from with his budget, move from draft budget position in the education budget to now final budget. He's going to put a further £80 million into the aggregated schools budget, which I think and I understand from the figures that are handed to me will do a lot to relieve those pressures that various principals, boards of governors across Northern Ireland and all constituencies were coming forward and talking about. But that is a sufficient enough investment to ensure that the worst of what was being talked about for the next academic year will not now arise.
Call Mr. Jimmy Spratt.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Can I thank the Minister for his statement today? And can I ask him, will the allocation to the Ulster Orchestra in the January monitoring round be enough to actually save the orchestra in the long run?
Mr. Speaker, I'm glad that the Member has raised this issue because it allows me to perhaps expand more than I was able to in the statement. There is only one allocation, which is a January monitoring allocation to the Ulster Orchestra, which I understand will be or should be sufficient to get it through its current financial problems, which have been well publicised. It does not deal with the longer term, but what I can assure the Member and I can assure those across Northern Ireland who are interested, not least the orchestra themselves, that we will continue to work with DECAL. DECAL are in the lead in this in terms of bringing forward a longer-term sustainable plan. And there are many ways in which I think we can do that. And we're looking at some options that have arisen even in the last few days that would allow the orchestra to move forward on a more sustainable footing so that whilst you know, it's maybe not viewed by many as the most important thing that we fund as an executive, it is obviously important as part of our overall tapestry of the arts and culture. It's something that we are able to have and say that we have here in Northern Ireland that supports the economy in a broad sense. So it's something that I'm very pleased to be able to announce today, and we'll continue to work ensuring that there is a longer-term strategy to save the orchestra.
Call Mr. Trevor Nunn.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I would like to welcome the £63 million. Obviously, it will be a big relief to hard-pressed principals everywhere through the education system. But in the Minister's own words, it's a good example of finding a way through our immediate problems. So would he agree with me that just as since the health and education, in his own words, account for 65% of the total resource payments, and that the Executive is committed to assessing the performance of the Department of Health, would it not be a good idea to also assess the performance of the Department of Education, which is in sore need of a root and branch reform?
I don't think you'll get much disagreement on this side of the House for the need to conduct, as we would do in any department. I would hope that ministers, irrespective of what party they belong to, would want to ensure that the money that is allocated to them by the executive through the budget process is spent as efficiently as possible. The minister is obviously in the middle of reforming in the sense of reducing down to one education board for the whole of Northern Ireland, which I would hope from my perspective will yield savings as we move forward and greater efficiencies. I think there are a lot of areas in which work can be done on, we're discussing with Mr. McKinney earlier what the front line was, but you know, I think within education, whilst playing an important role in the overall system, that there are clearly savings could be made in terms of school meals and in terms of some aspects of school transportation as well. And I would encourage the Minister, as I would encourage all Ministers, to continue to do that type of work on an ongoing basis. The Department of Education did have a piece of work done by the OECD, which was discreet on standards, and the OECD is obviously carrying out its review of the whole of the public sector in Northern Ireland, and it will not, in a situation where we have 65% of our budget going on health and education alone, it would not be a very good review being conducted by the OECD if it didn't, as well as concentrating on health, Deputy Speaker, also do some work with education too, and I'm keen to encourage that to be the case. And the Minister sits on my Improving Public Services Executive Subcommittee, which is taking forward the OECD work as well as other reform measures too.
Call Mrs. Dolores Kelly.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I wonder, Minister, could you give us any indication of when the penalty for the welfare reform will have to be paid, and if there's any further information you give us in relation to the mitigating factors and flexibilities obtained?
Mr. Deputy Speaker outlined in the statement that in a slight change, actually, which I didn't say in the statement, and a change to how Treasury are going to handle this this year, the current year that we're in, they were taking it out, the penalty out mid-year. This year they are taking it out at the start of the financial year, so we're losing £114 million off our starting position, so that adjusted our draft budget position and had to be dealt with. We are obviously able to deal with half of that. Are we able to deal with the entirety of that through capital budget? We have, as an executive, agreed to deal with half of it through a capital to revenue switch, and the other half we have dealt with as an overcommitment, because we believe that now that there is agreement across the House, including by the member's own party, to take forward the welfare reform legislation with adaptations to suit Northern Ireland, that the legislation will be in place halfway through the year. We will therefore then receive half of that penalty back to be able to use in year. So we've made that over commitment, which I think is a prudent thing to do. Of course, it doesn't bring back, unfortunately, the £100 million that has been lost to date because of the inability of the SDLP and Sinn Féin to move forward earlier in respect of welfare reform legislation. I will leave the detail of what is in the package of measures to the Social Development Minister whenever he brings to the House, as I hope he will in the next couple of weeks, welfare legislation.
Call Mr. Jim Allister.
Thank you. Though the Minister doesn't mention it in his statement, can he confirm that under this budget, the level of public debt in Northern Ireland will rise to an all-time high, and in 15-16 will be £1.8 billion. And that puts Northern Ireland in the unenviable position per head of population as carrying the heaviest debt of people in any of the devolved regions, money that has to be paid back.
Look, it's probably not a place to get into too much of the detail on this, and I'm happy to correspond with the member in more precise detail about what it is. But what I can say, the member is not far off in terms of the total figure in terms of debt that the executive has. Now, the executive has a facility, Deputy Speaker, to borrow up to £3 billion through the RRI scheme. To date, we have borrowed about 1.7. The member is right. That will go up to north of 1.8. I have in the past expressed concerns about continuing to borrow for infrastructure investment and the amount of revenue payments that have to be made, not just in terms of our RRI payments, but also for PPI and PFI and PPP projects. The total that we're paying out of our resource budget, which is a part of our budget which is under pressure at the minute, is around £60 million a year. Obviously, we'd rather not have to pay that back, but what that money is paying for is improvements to our infrastructure, which is what the investments have done in the past. Significantly, and I think this changes the scenario somewhat moving forward, is that now that we have the flexibility to spend £700 million of our RRI to capitalise the cost of a voluntary exit scheme, that will reduce our pay bill by around £500 million every single year moving forward from here on in, or from 2018-19, whenever the money has been spent. Savings will start to be realised from next year. So actually, in terms of spending it with a repayment, a very small interest repayment on it, it is a good investment to allow us to get ourselves back onto a sustainable long-term footing in terms of our public finances. It helps us to deal with the need where you have less money being spent on public services, where you don't need as many people to deliver those services. It is a flexibility that was hard fought and hard won during negotiations, and having it in place will allow us to do things in terms of reforming and restructuring our public sector that otherwise we wouldn't have been able to do. And Deputy Speaker, if we had not had access to this flexibility, we would still have had the cost of a voluntary exit scheme, but we wouldn't have had the source of finance and a fairly cheap and affordable way to be able to do that.
Call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Deputy Speaker, Minister Nicvey estimated that welfare cuts would amount to £250 million in Northern Ireland if we implement the reforms. The DSD Minister estimated to be £120 million. You set aside, or you budgeted on the base of £70 million a year to mitigate against the worst impacts of welfare reform. Given the gaps in those figures, does the Minister concede that this is a budget that Sinn Féin have agreed to, which implements welfare cuts?
I don't think it's really a concession on my part to accede to the point that this is a budget which is built upon moving forward with welfare reform. Unfortunately, we still have to contend with the penalties, which are the price of obstinance over the last number of years. Unnecessary obstinance over the last number of years has cost this executive £100 million at the time when we can least afford it. We are at last agreed as executive parties on a way forward on welfare reform. As I said to Mrs Kelly, the detail of that, of the basis on which we are moving forward in terms of the detail of the package of measures will become clear over the next number of weeks. But you know, what I can say is that whilst accepting and acknowledging that that welfare reform will not be a good thing for everybody in Northern Ireland, and I don't want to get into the arguments about why welfare reform can actually be good for some people in Northern Ireland, and encouraging them back into work and simplifying the system of benefits that we have, which can be very complex and very complicated for a lot of people, including members of this House, that we could not, as an executive, whatever the cost, and there was a lot of work done on what the cost would be, various ranging estimates about what the cost could be. This executive did not have the means, Deputy Speaker, to fill in that hole itself. We simply couldn't have done that, and at the same time then have to develop an IT infrastructure to pay benefits within Northern Ireland. That simply was something that was not affordable. But what we could afford to do, and this is where agreement was reached across the parties, is to do our best within what we could afford to mitigate against some of the worst effects of welfare reform in Northern Ireland. Now, would we like to have done more? I'm sure we all would have. But in the circumstances that we find ourselves in, I think the agreement that has been reached, which will be outlined in more detail by the DSD Minister in due course, will show that what we have been able to achieve in Northern Ireland far surpasses what is builds upon the GB system, and far surpasses what has happened in England, and is the envy as well of my counterparts, other ministers in places like Scotland and Wales, where they would be very pleased to have the flexibilities that we have in the package of measures that we are able to implement through the use of some of our own budget.
Call Mr John McAllister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Would the Minister agree that having delayed on public sector reform for so many years is now going to cost us even more, and Mr Allister's point about debt? Would he also accept that one of the biggest obstacles he faces as Minister is, in the words of the First Minister, the dysfunctionality of the Executive? Would he accept that those parties who cannot bring themselves to vote for the budget that are in the Executive really ought to think whether they should remain in position?
It's not, I have, certainly have a view on it, but it's probably not my place today to start lecturing to those parties who are in the Executive. Well, I've probably lectured enough already. Those parties who are in the Executive, but continue to adopt the, I think you could characterise it as a cynical position where they vote against, knowing that this is a budget which does contain difficult decisions and tough choices. And they're in the, I suppose, the luxurious position of being able to vote against it, knowing full well that their vote is not required to carry it. They can then sort of Pontius Pilate, like, wash their hands of the worst effects. So if something happens next year which people don't like as a result of the pressures that departments are facing, those parties can say, of course, it's nothing to do with us. But all the while, as the member points out, and he points out regularly, they remain within the Executive. And it's for them to explain why they continue to remain within the Executive when they cannot back a budget, which I think on balance in the circumstances that we are in is a good budget and represents a good deal for the people of Northern Ireland. In respect of reform and the pace of reform, I think we should have, in the past, should have more quickly embraced the need to reform. I can understand why perhaps believing that, the member will of course remember as running as a Conservative in the last election. The last general election, how we were going to be promised that the economy was going to turn around and the deficit would be slashed and everything would be hunky-dory from about this time on. And that, of course, hasn't been the case. If that had been the case, we probably wouldn't have needed to reform just as aggressively as we are going to now. But I'm glad, however we've got there, I'm glad that the Executive has now agreed and is on the same place across all of the parties on the need to reform, the need to restructure, whether that be a voluntary exit scheme or also the greater use of shared services or the likes of the OECD review or the use of the Public Sector Reform Division within my own department. All departments are now moving in the right direction on that, and there is unanimity across executive parties that this is what we should be doing and this is what we absolutely need to do in the next number of years.
Mr. Paul Frew.
Speaker, I'd be very brief and I just welcome the Minister's statement, but what does this Budget Minister mean specifically for the devolution of corporation tax powers?
This budget, Deputy Speaker, doesn't do anything specifically in respect of corporation tax because Where it will affect our budgets most directly is in future years, whenever we, as a result of the Azores ruling, we have to ensure that we are not receiving any benefit for it and we have to pay whatever the cost of devolving it is. That will not hit until, I suppose, best estimates after the devolution, which I'm very much welcome. I haven't had a chance in the House to welcome the fact that the government have published the legislation to allow this, this power to be devolved to this House. It will be at least 2017-18 before we are seeing that budget hit in terms of reduction in public expenditure to pay for corporation tax. What it does do for corporation tax is it, I think it starts to prepare the way for it. I think it's important that even in a time whenever we're facing budget reductions, that we still continue to focus on that long term of lowering corporation tax. So that's why you will see a 10% increase in the DETI budget to continue to allow it to do its work, a lot of which is working now to ensure that investments are secured in future years, and also the additional money that has been put specifically to skills development and money given back to universities and colleges so that they can continue to create that pipeline of skilled workers that our economy needs now and will also need in the future post the devolution and lowering of the corporation tax rate.
Call the final speaker, Mr. Sammy Douglas. And you'll have to be very brief.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Thank the Minister for his statement this morning and today. And the Minister mentioned about the Social Innovation Fund, which will be a great boost for the third sector, including social enterprises, charities, community funding groups and faith-based organisations. So could I ask the Minister when that scheme will be up and running?
Mr. Deputy Speaker, this is a scheme and a fund that I want to take forward using, if I can get an executive agreement, which I've yet to secure, that will use the dormant accounts money that has been sitting unallocated over the last number of years. There's about £5 million unallocated. I hope that we can, in the same way as the investment fund, leverage in another £5 million on that and take it up to a fund of £10 million, which will go, I hope, as loans to organisations in the third sector, whether they be faith-based organisations, community groups, charities, whatever it might be, social enterprises, to allow them to continue to invest in the work that they do to help us in government deliver services, particularly to those who are hard to reach within our society.
Order. That concludes questions on the statement, and can I put on record my thanks to members who cooperated. We got through an extraordinary high number of members who were able to ask questions, and that can only be good for democracy.